Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we come to Thee once more, and we come, O Lord, to thank Thee for Thy great mercy and goodness toward us. Above all, we thank Thee for Him in whose name we venture to approach Thee, realizing that apart from Him we can do nothing, and least of all when we desire to seek Thy face. So we come, O Lord, and rejoice that we are accepted in the Beloved. We pray Thee to enable us to realize this more and more, so that furthermore we shall desire ever to live to His glory and to His praise, and especially as when we have the privilege of standing before others to make known the riches of Thy grace in Him. So we once more ask that Thou wouldest look down upon us in pity and mercy and compassion. Help us, O Lord, to concentrate upon these things. We do realize our utter final dependency upon Thee and the power of Thy might through Thy Spirit. But enable us to lay hold on everything else that can minister to this end. So we commit and commend ourselves to Thee once more, praying that Thou wouldest be pleased to look upon us and to bless us. Pardon and forgive us our every sin, and especially our sins and our failures in connection with these most holy things. We plead nothing but the name and the merit of Thy dear Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, now we've reached the stage at which we've considered the preparation of the sermon, and we've considered certain things that are common both to the preparation of the sermon and the preparation of ourselves and the actual act of preaching. Now, all of this so far has been preparation. In other words, our ideas concerning these things. So the one question that seems to me to be left, therefore, is this. Some of you may consider it a trivial one, but I want to try to show that it has its importance. Should you announce beforehand the subject on which you're going to preach? You'll have to face this problem, because churches seem to like this, and especially those who advertise their services in newspapers and so on. It has become the custom to announce the subject. Well, now, I take the view here that this is something that one should not do, that it's a wrong practice. I say that for many reasons, but the first and the overriding reason is that people should come to the house of God to worship God and to listen to an exposition of the Word and of His truth, whatever it may be, whatever aspect, whatever portion, it doesn't matter. That should be the thing that they should be concerned about, not some particular subject or question. I think this is wrong because I think it's bad for the people. I feel that it encourages a pseudo-intellectualism. I call it that because I'm sure that that is the ultimate reason for it. This was a practice that came in last century. As far as one can gather, it wasn't done before that. And people would come together in the way that I'm saying to worship God and to listen to the exposition of the Scripture. But then this notion became current about the middle of the last century, that we were now educated and we were now intellectuals and we must have subjects. It was a part of that whole turning which took place in the middle of the last century, which in Britain we call Victorianism, and there was as much Victorianism in this country as there was in Britain. This, as I've already referred to it in connection with the buildings and so on, I do commend to you this study of the subtle change that took place somewhere round about the middle of the last century. A change from the old idea of meeting together to worship God and to listen to the exposition of Scripture and the waiting of the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the preacher and upon the whole service, the change from that into a more man-centered type of service. We've seen how this works out in evangelism and so on. It's the Arminian outlook, and Finney, Moody, and all the rest. Well, but I think this was a part of it, this interest in subjects, you see, that we are no longer simple people, but we want more or less an address or a lecture rather than to come under the power of the preaching of the word. So I think it's bad because it encourages this pseudo-intellectualism, but it also encourages a too theoretical approach to truth. I've been dealing with this in terms of the preacher, that it's bad for him. Well, then it's very much worse for the people. And another way in which I can put this is that it has the tendency to isolate subjects from the scriptures, and indeed ultimately to regard the scriptures as but a collection or a series of statements about particular subjects. And so one atomizes the scripture and forgets the whole. And surely the whole is more important than the parts. This seems to me to be a bad practice, that it pulls out these subjects, tends to isolate them from their context, tends indeed to isolate them even from one another. This is, it's only a danger. But I feel it is a danger in this way. And so one loses this wholeness of the biblical message and becomes interested in particular subjects and questions. But a still more important reason, I would say, and this is a pastoral one, but of course you can't divide these things into watertight compartments. Why are people interested in these subjects? Well, the answer is that they think they know what they need. They put it in terms of what they want, but they think they know what they need. They're tremendously interested in certain subjects. This is what they want to hear about. Well, you must have already gathered that it is a part of my whole contention that they are not in a position, ultimately, to know what they need. And it's a part of our work to diagnose them and to discover this. Because so often, their idea as to what they need is quite wrong. Of course, this applies to us also. But it certainly applies to the congregations. And therefore, it is a part of our whole approach to this matter not to allow this dictation, as I say, and not to encourage them along this line, but rather to give them the whole truth and to bring them to see that there are aspects that they are not interested in, apparently. They should be interested in it all. And we must show them that they need this. Or, let me put it in this form to you. There is always this danger of becoming lopsided and lacking in balance in the Christian life. Some people, you see, are tremendously keen, as they say, on prophecy. They want to know if you're preaching on prophecy. If you are, they'll be there. There'll be no question about this. I've discovered this so many times. I remember the late Dr. Campbell Morgan, my predecessor, telling me once, jocularly, if you want an exceptionally large crowd, announce that you're going to preach on prophecy, and you'll get them. Then all these people, they've got this lust after particular subjects, prophecy, holiness, and so on. Well, now, if we, therefore, announce subjects in this way, we tend to increase this danger of a lopsided, imbalanced Christian life. But let me finish and deal finally with this matter by putting it like this. As a generalization now, it's often amazed me to notice how churches and preachers hold on to 19th century methods when they've long since said farewell to the great emphasis, especially of the early part of the 19th century, in a theological sense. And I'm most amazed of all that this should happen in evangelical circles. You see, this whole business of announcing the subject, and indeed of having a choir, and of having a children's address, all these things came in the last century. They were not done before. It was a part of this pseudo-intellectualism. And we are now experiencing a kind of hangover from this. And I'm calling attention to the thing in order to try to stimulate you to break into these bad habits. this false respectability and intellectualism that was so characteristic of the last century from the middle onwards. These things have become dominating in church services, and I feel that they're detracting from the preaching of the gospel and the centrality of the preaching of the gospel. Let's learn to ask, why should I do this? How did this ever start? And so on. And I think you'll find that so many of these things are simply hangovers, as I'm putting it, of what was introduced very wrongly and for the wrong reasons towards the middle of the last century. Well, as evangelicals, we should be more concerned to do this than anybody else, surely. Very well, let's leave that at that. But the next thing follows, I think, from that in a way. And this is the whole question of radio and television preaching. I don't want to spend time on this. I dealt with it in the introduction to this series, but I've got to just bring it in at this point, because you may well be invited to do this kind of thing. Well, I personally, again, am an opponent of this, and have refused to do so, with one or two exceptions, because of very special occasions throughout my life. I did so because I hold the view, and still hold it, that these ways of communicating truth have been inimical to true preaching. In fact, I would suggest that probably in this century, and especially since about 1920 or so on, have been one of the major factors in militating against a belief in preaching. The argument is, of course, the results that you get, and you'll hear wonderful and thrilling stories of somebody accidentally turning on the radio and suddenly hearing a word which arrested them and they were converted, and so on. And the same with television. It's always the argument from results. But I think we've got to examine this very carefully, because there are many sides to this question. My rooted objection to doing this is very largely that the service is so controlled. Of course, it has to be. These people have to draw up programs. Only a given amount of time is allotted. From their standpoint, this is perfectly all right, but I argue that from the standpoint of preaching, it is all wrong. It militates against the freedom of the spirit. If I've warned you against the danger of allowing the congregation to dictate in this respect, well, how much more do we need to be warned against allowing radio and television authorities to do this? And they will do it, because they're interested primarily from the commercial standpoint. But quite apart from that, even, it is surely wrong at any time to start in fetters or in chains with any kind of time limit. I remember once having a discussion on this whole question with the religious director of our British Broadcasting Corporation, who had been good enough to ask me to preach more than once. And the simple way I put it to him was this. I said, what would happen to your programs if the Holy Spirit suddenly descended upon the preacher and possessed him? What would happen to your programs? And of course he couldn't answer. The answer would be, of course, that you'd be turned off. But what a terrible thing to do. You see, we are not in charge, and therefore it is wrong, it seems to me, to be hemmed in like this by these time considerations and proprieties and so on. Not only that, he made clear, and they always have to, of course, that having their eye partly on people who are in hospitals and so on, you've got to have a certain number of hymns and prayers and so on, and the preaching is crowded out. They don't want much of that. And in any case, they would be disturbed if you should preach on certain aspects of the truth, the question of death and judgment and so on. Now, from their standpoint, of course, one can well understand this. But from our standpoint, surely this is not legitimate. But with regard to this whole question of results, we need to look into this. I would suggest that actually, if you really sifted them, you'd find that the results are very few in number. They always get great publicity, and you're never told very much about what happens to them afterwards. But even granting that, what we have to bear in mind is the difference between particular results and the whole trend of a method. Now, this to me is a very important point. I'm prepared to grant, for the sake of argument, that there are individual conversions and so on. But when you come to evaluate a thing like this, I suggest that you should evaluate it in terms of its total effect upon the life of the church. And there, I do not think that there's any question at all that the effect has been a bad one. Now, I'll give you just one illustration of what I mean. I was in this country of yours once, a few years back, and I was preaching in a church where in the morning there were two services because of the number of people who came, one service at 9:30 and the other at 11. And one was asked to repeat the service exactly. I was one of those people who couldn't do that. It was meant to be verbatim so that the two congregations would have exactly the same thing. However, in the evening, the service was broadcast, and I was most interested to find the first Sunday that having had two congregations in the morning, one, say, of 1,400 people and the other of 1,200 people, my total congregation at night was about 400, and that was customary, I was told, in that church. But this was the interesting thing that happened. I wasn't familiar with this procedure. It came roughly to this, that we began the service about 7:45, and the song leader was in charge. Well, then green light came on to say that we were on the air, and then there was more singing and so on and so forth. And I was instructed that when I started preaching, the green light would be there, but then at a given point a red light would appear, which was the sign, of course, that I was to end, and everything should really be over by then. By the red light I should be pronouncing the benediction. Well, on we went, and I could see the time going and began to feel rather anxious. This service was due to finish at 9:05, and I found to my dismay that I was on my feet at 9:25, leaving me, you see, just a bare, well, not full 20 minutes, because we'd had to have the last hymn and the benediction before 9:05. Well, I was in great trouble. I thought first that it was my duty to cut down what I intended saying to this space of time, and I began trying to do that. But as it happened, I suddenly found I was being given exceptional freedom. So while I went on speaking, there was this great discussion going on within me. Should I be guided by this program, or should I be guided by what seemed to me to be the influence and the power of the Spirit upon me? And I decided that I would be quenching the Spirit and guilty of sin if I observed their rules and regulations. So when I saw the red light coming on, I took no notice whatsoever. And I went on and finished preaching at 9:25. Well, now, you wait a minute. Let me tell you the sequel. That was my first Sunday in that church. I then had to go up to some conference and came back again for the following Sunday. There were three assistant ministers in that church, and they were very nice men, and I'd apologized to them the first Sunday night for what I'd done and hoped they wouldn't get into trouble and told them to lend it all on me. Well, when I got back the next Sunday morning, they were there to greet me, and I said, "I hope you haven't had too bad a week." They said, "We've had a terrible week." And, well, I said, "I hope you explained to them that it was entirely due to me." And I said, "I hope you apologized on my behalf, that I wasn't accustomed to this, and I must try to make amends." But they said that wasn't the trouble we had at all. I said, "Well, what was your trouble?" Well, they said, "We've never had so many complaints about a service, never." I said, "What was the complaint?" They said, "Well, the complaints were these. The people were writing in and saying, 'Why didn't you give that man more time to preach? We want to know how that sermon went on. What did it lead to? Where did it end? Why did you have all that singing? Why that quartet? Why that solo? We can have singing at other times. Why not give this man more time?' And the result was this: second time, I was given the time. They cut everything down to the bone, and I was given about 3/4 hour for my sermon. But now this is, you see, the interesting thing. I told those men afterwards, I said, "You know, if I were the minister of this church, I would not broadcast this evening service, but I would advertise this church in these terms: the church which doesn't broadcast." Why? Well, for this reason. I think then the people would come out for the evening service. You see, as long as they can sit at home and listen to it, why take the trouble to get out your car and to trouble and struggle with the traffic and all the rest of it? You hear it at home. It's discouraged people from coming to the house of God. It's taught them bad habits. They just want to listen like this to sermons. So I do really regard this as something very bad, because it is doing harm to the whole notion of the corporate life of the church. People have got to think of churches just in places where you sit and listen to a sermon. And now you can get it on the radio, you can get it on tapes and so on. And so the whole notion of coming together and sitting together round the word and listening to an exposition of it is seriously damaged. And I think that the facts are demonstrating this, that during these years, the life of the church per se as such has deteriorated very seriously. And therefore, I again suggest that it's up to us to break into all this. The reasons why men have done it, of course, have been obvious. They thought it was going to do good to their churches, and people hearing them would come and listen, and so on. Well, I'm suggesting that it really hasn't worked out like that, and that you are likely to find in the future that God is going to revive his work in the church. And it is those who attend regularly are the ones who are going to participate most of all in the blessing. And the astonishing thing once more is that people don't want to do this, that they're content with this detached attitude towards these matters. It is a fundamental failure to understand the true doctrine of the Christian church, the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, the gathering together of the people of God. Now, we don't want to make this mechanical or force people to do it. What I'm saying is that our preaching ought to fill them with a desire to do this. You don't have to whip them up to do it. Look at those people in Acts 2, daily, you remember. House to house, daily. Continued steadfastly in these things. This idea that people are content with one service on a Sunday, it's just a failure to understand the true character of the Christian, who's like a newborn babe thirsting for this milk of the word and the desire to be with his fellows. It seems to me to be indicative of a wrong view of the church and of the individual Christian as a newborn babe. Well, you see, we've allowed these outside forces to influence us overmuch, and I'm suggesting it's time we broke into it all and really tried to get back to the New Testament picture of the church and to conduct our services in that way. Very well, let me leave that at that. I now come, therefore, these are all preliminaries. We've made our preparations. Now then, I've got next to consider with you the things to avoid in preaching. Things to avoid in preaching. Of course, we've been dealing with some of them already, but these are, I feel, extras. First of all, the preacher himself. What has he got to avoid? First and foremost, professionalism. It is the curse of the ministry, professionalism. It's a thing you'll have to fight against as long as you're alive. Professionalism is to me hateful anywhere, everywhere. When I was practicing medicine, I hated professionalism even there. There's a type of medical practitioner who's more professional than able. He's got all the airs and graces and the things to do and the things to say, but he's generally a bad doctor. The greater the doctor, the less evidence there'll be of this professionalism. Well, it's infinitely more true in the realm of the ministry. But let me say a little more of what I mean by this. There is nothing more terrible that can happen to a preacher than that his main reason for preaching on a Sunday morning is that he's been announced to do so. You see what I mean by that? It's become his job. He's lost contact with the thing that originally moved him and urged him. It's now a routine. It's a job. And if he really asked himself honestly as he walks up the pulpit steps, why am I doing this? He would have to give that as the answer. I've been announced to do so. Therefore, I must do so. That's a manifestation of professionalism. And then, of course, it comes out in so many ways during the service. A man is too formal. Everything he does is too studied. This is always a sign of professionalism. I remember a man, again in medicine, if I may illustrate it, and we were all amused, those of us who were not trying to imitate him and to become professional as he was, the way this man used to apply his stethoscope to the patient's chest. It had nothing to do with medicine at all. He wasn't very good at interpreting what he heard, but the airs and graces with which he applied the stethoscope. No doubt it could affect people and help people who were only suffering from some psychosomatic or psychological condition. But if you were really ill, it didn't help you. It was more flourish than factual and of value. Well, but this happens. You watch men in pulpits, and it's pathetic to notice the stances and the studied character of almost everything that is done. There was a famous preacher in London. He actually used to turn round a complete circle as the service went on, so that people would have the advantage of seeing the back of his head as well as his face, and his wonderfully cultivated and ordered hair, and so on. Literally, this happened. And people crowded to see this. But that's sheer professionalism of the worst type. In other words, the professional is a man who's always watching himself. He's always watching himself. And he's always tremendously interested in techniques. This sort of man has always gone round listening to others, picking up ideas, watching how men do various things, and then they try to imitate them and to put them into practice. I believe you have something similar in the realm of acting in the theatre. There was a time when a man was a born actor and he just went and acted, but I believe they've introduced something which is called the method. And they all tend to be doing the same thing, you see, the method. It's no longer real acting in the old sense, it's applying this method. And then there are many other things that one's got to avoid. One's got to avoid a display of knowledge, one of the besetting sins of preachers, trying to give this impression of wide reading and so on. Well, I've emphasized the place and the value of reading, but if your whole object is to show your reading and to make a display of your knowledge, it's obviously bad in every sense. Another thing which I would emphasize tremendously is this: the danger of relying on your preparation. It's a terrible thing, this, but I'm sure every preacher would agree with me when I say this. See, the danger is that having finished your preparation, whenever that may be, but let's assume that it's on a Saturday evening or somewhere like that early, the danger now is to say, well, now then I'm ready for tomorrow. Because you got a good sermon. You've finished your preparation. And you put your reliance on that. There's no greater danger in the ministry and ministry of preaching than just that. You'll be let down by it, you'll be disappointed, and you'll be less effective. It's an awful temptation. You see, that's why I've emphasized the preparation of the man himself and so on. And I shall deal with it once more before we are finished. But I just put it in at this point. Watch this. Watch it carefully. You'll find yourself doing it. Say, right. And you're not right. Just say that to yourself, and you'll be able to correct it. And then, of course, the preachers then in the pulpit, many a man relies on a good voice. Many a man's proud of his voice and gives a display of it. Astonishing. But you see, you're always fighting the devil, and he's there with you. Then many a man, perhaps, who hasn't a good voice may rely on his eloquence or his oratory and so on. I mustn't weary with these things. Let me try and sum it up by saying, what advice would I give at this point? Well, I'm entitled to do so as a great sinner, as one who's fought this battle for so many years. I would say I would put it like this to you. Watch your natural gifts and tendencies and idiosyncrasies. Watch them. What I mean by that is this, that they will tend to run away with you. If you like, I'll put it in a phrase. Watch your strength. Not so much your weaknesses. It's your strength you've got to watch. It's the things at which you excel, the things at which you're good. They are the ones that are most likely to trip you, because they are the ones that will tend to lead you to make a display of them, and to pander to self, and so on. So watch these, and watch your idiosyncrasies. We've all got them, but we must watch these. Perhaps I could put it like this to you. The preacher always has to guard himself against this terrible temptation to be a character. You see, people like a character. And if a man has got these certain elements in him, you know what I mean by character, that he's something a bit out of the ordinary about him and something which people regard as attractive. His danger is to pander to this and to play up to this. And in the end, he's just calling attention to himself. Men like to be quaint or odd or different, and to get people to talk about them. This is the danger. So I'm putting it in that form. Beware of this, and especially watch your strong points. They're the ones that'll get you down. Let me put this in the form of a picture. I remember once hearing a man preach on Absalom. This was the whole point he was making. I don't know that exegetically it's a sound point, but it certainly, you see, impressed itself on me. You remember Absalom was very proud of his hair, his wonderful hair that he'd got. And he used to pay great attention to this and to make his boast of it. And you remember that finally it was his undoing. He got caught up by his hair in those trees as he was going through, and gave the opportunity to Joab to thrust the spear into him. The man's point was that this great strength of his hair, was his final undoing. All right. You see, I've remembered that, so that sometimes, even though a man doesn't always keep to the rules, he gets his lesson home. That doesn't justify breaking the rules. So all I'm saying to you is, watch your strength, whatever it may be, your hair or anything else. Don't display it. Very well, so I sum it up by putting it like this. The greatest, obviously, of all the temptations to a preacher is pride. Pride, because he's set up there, almost on a pedestal. He's standing in a pulpit. He's above the people, everybody looking at him. He's got this leading place in the church, in the community. And his greatest temptation of all is pride, and it takes terrible and horrible forms, and many, many forms. But as long as one realizes this, all is well. I've already said something about how to deal with it. Let me repeat this, because it is so important. The best way of checking any tendency to pride in your preaching or in anything else that you may do in that way, is on Sunday nights to read the biography of some great saint. Doesn't matter which of them. There are plenty of them. You can get the books and read them. But if you think you've done amazingly well and that nobody's ever preached like that before, well, just dip into Whitfield's journals, and I'll guarantee you'll be cured in less than 5 minutes. Or take up David Brainerd or somebody like that. And if that doesn't bring you to earth, then I say you are just a pure professional and you're beyond hope. But that's the antidote. Bring yourself down. Well, those are some of the special dangers confronting the preacher. But now, with regard to the sermon, you see, I'm putting it here because so far when I was dealing with the preparation of the sermon, I was anxious to do it in general. These are sort of special points, refinements on top of what we've been saying. Now, as regards the sermon itself, beware of too much intellect. I put that first. I put that first particularly to you people. I wouldn't have to put it first to everybody. But to some, this has got to come first. I remember a bit of advice given me many years ago. I was preaching on one occasion with another preacher. That used to be the custom in Wales at that time, on special occasions, to have two preachers. And they both preached together in a service, the younger men first and the older men afterwards. But that began to be varied, and I found myself preaching alone in the afternoon, and then the old men had preached alone in the morning, and we both preached together at night. Well, he heard me preaching in the afternoon alone, and it was the first time he'd heard me. So as we were being driven in a car together to have some tea, you don't have tea, but we have tea between the afternoon and evening meetings. He said to me, he was an old man, he was at that point exactly 60 years older than I was. He said, he was quite kind to me, he wanted to encourage me, but he gave me a very serious warning. He said, the great defect in that sermon this afternoon was this, he said, that you were overtaxing your people. You were giving them too much. And then he went on to put it like this. He said, I'll give you a rule, remember it as long as you live. Only 1 in 12 of your congregation is really intelligent. Only 1 in 12, that was his assessment. Remember that, he said. They can't take it. It's impossible for them to take it. You're only stunning them, and therefore you're not helping them. And then he said to me, he said, you watch now what I do tonight. He said, I shall be saying one thing, really, but I'll say it in 3 different ways, and that was precisely what he did. He was a very intellectual man, very able man. There may well be some of his commentaries in the library here. But that's what he told me. So I'm putting it in this form to you. Beware of too much intellect. You see, it's inevitable, isn't it, that you should fall to this danger because you spend so many years in studying and in reading and in discussing with others, and you tend to assume that everybody's like that. But you're not. You're strange birds. And and remember that these people are very different. They haven't had time. They're business people, all sorts of things. Beware, then, of too much intellect. Of course, I would equally emphasize beware of too little, but that's not the thing that needs to be emphasized here. And I'm preaching, you see, to my congregation, as I've told you always to do, not to somebody else who isn't here. But there are people to whom it is necessary to say, beware of too much sentiment and immersion. The first man hasn't sufficient of this. Too intellectual. But then there are some people who are nothing but emotional and sentimental. I've heard men give a text and then they start telling stories, and on and on and on they go, and they become more and more sentimental. That's bad. And then there are those who need to be warned against mere exhortation. So often men think that preaching just means an extended exhortation. They start exhorting the people. It's all application. They don't present the truth and make the application inevitable. The whole time they're getting at their people and slashing them and exhorting them and calling them to do this and that and forcing them. Too much exhortation. There are some men who don't exhort at all. They've given this brilliant intellectual disquisition and it's left at that. There's nothing to move anybody to tears or to action. No emotion, no feeling, no exhortation. Well, now, all this obviously is wrong. So I put it in that form of beware of too much of any of these. Well, then I come to another. The place of polemics in a sermon and in preaching. Now, the polemic element is, of course, important. And it has its very definite place. It is good for the people. But I'm warning now against the danger of too much polemic. And I think that this will be the danger of most of you again. You've been struggling with rival theories and heresies and things of this description, and your mind is naturally full of this. But I say be careful that you don't have too much of this. Why? Well, the people, the bulk of the people, to start with, are probably not interested. A large number of them don't even understand. Remember that there are such people. Well, I'm saying there is a place for it. I'm saying that there mustn't be too much. And, of course, you have always got a certain number in the congregation who are too interested in polemics. And it's very bad for them, of all people. They're the people who will travel miles in order to hear a slashing attack on a man or on a theory or any or the rest of it. And as you know, men who are always polemical generally get a good hearing, and they generally get good collections also. But this is a real snare. Now, I'm so concerned about this because I've seen good men ruined in this way, and I've seen good ministers ruined. I've seen great preachers ruined, I think, by this. Shall I tell you about a discussion I once had with one of them, but I'm not going to mention his name. But he was one of the greatest of these polemical preachers. And I had the privilege of spending a day with him many years ago. And we got onto this theme. We got onto it through his asking me a question. He said, do you read Joseph Parker? This was a great preacher in London until about 1901. And he published great volumes of sermons, The People's Bible. He said, do you read Joseph Parker? I said, no, I read very little of Joseph Parker. And he was amazed at this. He said, oh, I read Joseph Parker every Sunday morning. Always, he said. Always read Joseph Parker before I go to church on Sunday morning. He puts me right, you know, he said. Old Parker, he said, was wonderful, he said. I can't tell you how I enjoy reading old Parker making mincemeat of those modernists of his age and liberals, which gave me my opportunity. I said, well, you know, I said, I must confess that doesn't appeal to me. What exactly did Joseph Parker achieve after he'd made mincemeat of these people? Well, that set us off. And we had this great discussion. And I only remember now, it went on for the whole day. But I only remember 3 points in the discussion, which I'm repeating to you because I trust they'll be of some help to you. He, at one point, said to me, no, but look here, he said, I was suggesting to him, I was trying to appeal to him, that he was ruining his great ministry by having these tirades every Sunday night in particular, either on some teaching, it was very often Roman Catholicism, or even on persons. They were brilliantly done, but I was trying to suggest to him it was ruining his ministry. But he said, you're unscriptural. He said, let me remind you, he said, that the Apostle Paul tells us in Galatians 2 that when Peter went astray, the Apostle withstood him to the face. He said, that's all I'm doing. He said, I'm doing what Paul did. Surely this is right. To which I replied, I said, yes, I know that Paul tells us that he did that, but I said, I am interested in the result. I noticed that the result of Paul's dealing with Peter and tackling him face to face at Antioch was that he persuaded Peter that he was wrong and won him to his position. And Peter later on in life expresses his great admiration of the Apostle Paul and his writings. Can you say the same about the people whom you attack? And of course he could only get up and walk away from me for a while. If you can win people to the truth and to see your position by your polemics, all right. But be very careful that you do so and that you don't end by antagonizing this man still more, and antagonizing a number of others at the same time. Well, then I remember later on in the discussion, a second argument came up. He said, look here. He said, I'll put this to you as a medical man. He said, now, here you are. Here's a surgeon. And there's a patient. He's got a growth in his system. If that growth is allowed to go on growing, it'll kill that man. There's only one hope for him. That growth has got to be extirpated. It's got to be removed by a surgical operation. He said the surgeon doesn't want to operate, but to save that man's life, he's got to do it. He's got to get this cancer out of the man's system and body. He said, that's precisely my position. He said, I don't want to do this sort of thing, but he said, I've got to. This cancer has come into the church. It's got to be removed, got to be extirpated. What was the reply to that? Well, one had to think quickly, but the reply to me was an obvious one. I said, you know, you've chosen an unfortunate illustration. Perhaps I know more about surgeons than you do. I said, there is such a thing as developing the surgical mentality. And it's a thing one's got to be very wary of. I said, if you really are ever taken very ill, never accept the verdict of a surgeon alone. Always check it, either by your general practitioner or by some physician. Why do I say this? I'll tell you why I said. The surgeon tends to develop the surgical mentality and outlook. And unconsciously, the moment he looks at a patient, he tends to think in terms of operation. Take it out. Take it out. Now, this is actual fact. This is actual fact. And I've always told people, never submit to the opinion of a surgeon alone. Always check it. So I said, would you tell me that you can say honestly that you're quite free from this surgical mentality? Haven't you rather got into the way now of immediately wanting to operate, as it were? And you're doing it constantly. And again, you see, he was in some kind of a difficulty. But then I remember the third argument. He said, well, listen to this, he said. This surely will prove it to you. He said, every time I indulge in what you call one of these exceptional tirades of mine, and they were tirades, he would attack people by name and say the most scurrilous things about them. He said, every time I do this, which you say is so harmful, he said, you know the result? The circulation of my paper, he says, simply rockets up. What do you say to that, he said? Well, I said, what I say to that is this. I've noticed always, whenever there are two dogs fighting, a crowd always gathers. And I think it is the answer. There are people who enjoy this. I'm not surprised the circulation goes up. You attack things and appeal for money, you'll always get people to support you. But it's negative. It's destructive. There's no question about it. So I say, be careful of too much polemics. You see, this particular man I'm talking about, he ended his life almost in isolation, and his church had gone down to but a handful from having been a great church. I knew another man who imitated the men about whom I've been speaking. And while he was alive and able to indulge in these polemics, he had a great crowd every Sunday night. He died, and within about 3 months, his church was almost empty. These people used to gather together from everywhere to hear this, and it appealed to the flesh, and they enjoyed it. But he hadn't been building up a church. You can't build up a church on polemics. You can't build up a church on apologetics, even. Still less on polemics. You've got to give the people the positive truth. But again, to be perfectly fair, let me say that you must be aware of too little polemics. There are some people, you know, like to have the reputation of being nice men, and it's said of them they're never negative. And they like to say that about themselves. Never negative. Always positive. It's humbug. It's sheer humbug and hypocrisy. The scripture has the polemical element, and it must be present in our preaching. We've got to warn our people, and we've got to guide them. But you mustn't let yourself develop this idea that you are the defender of the truth, and you're always doing it, and you're always attacking people and points of view. It becomes negative, and there's no life in it, and it certainly will ruin the life of your church. You won't be building up your people. And under this heading, I would say this. Beware, also keep your eye carefully on the use of irony. It has its place. It has its place, but be careful with it. Most people completely misunderstand it, and they don't realize you're being ironical, and they take you literally, and then they're offended by it. So be careful with it. It can be used. Sometimes it has to be used. But be careful. It's a dangerous weapon. Ridicule, I think we should really always avoid. So the balance in this matter is in the sermon, isn't it? As Paul puts it to the Philippians in chapter 1, we are set for the defense and the propagation of the gospel. It isn't defense only. Don't just become a self-appointed guardian of the faith or a defender of the faith. Defense and the propagation. Let there be this balance. And let there be more propagation than defense. Build up the people. Give them a balanced message. Preach the whole counsel of God to them. Now, lastly, in delivery. Now, there are many things here in connection with the actual delivery of the sermon. I've known a man who never walked into his pulpit on Sunday morning. He always ran into his pulpit. Invariably. The man I saw doing it and have seen doing it more than once, he was imitating another man who used to do it. He ran into the pulpit. The idea was, you see, how keen they were to preach to him. Well, that, of course, is again calling attention to self. But there's one thing even worse than running into the pulpit, which I think is wrong, of course. The other is putting on a smile when you've got there. You've seen it happen, haven't you? The man there puts on this smile in the pulpit. And then, I'm reprobating all this, then greeting your congregation, walking into your pulpit and saying, "Good morning, folks. How nice it is to see you. And how good of you it is to come." You know, and thanking them for coming. And then, still worse, cracking a joke or two, just to put the people at ease. Now, people do this kind of thing. I've heard people saying that they would justify that in an evangelistic campaign, in a hall and so on. I say it is wrong always, everywhere, in connection with this work. But obviously, how wrong in a place of worship. Why is this wrong? Well, I say the whole approach is wrong. It isn't our service. They're not coming there to us. We are not people inviting them into our home, as it were. It isn't our service at all. They and we are there to worship God and to meet with God. And what we must try to do is to show them that this is something absolutely and entirely different from everything they do everywhere else. It's not like a man inviting you into his home. He's not in charge here. He's just a servant himself. We are all going together into the presence of the living God. I cannot emphasize too much this point that we should go out of our way to show the difference between this. You see, the whole other notion is, well, no, there's nothing strange about this. So you say, "Good morning, folks," and you put them at ease and a few jokes and all is well. If you want to do that sort of thing in your own home, do so. But it isn't your home. You yourself are under God. Emphasize this difference. Shall I show you this point by putting it in a way which really makes it quite ridiculous? I knew a deacon once who, poor fellow, was anxious to show always what a nice and pleasant man he was, and indeed he was, but he tended to play on this. And this is what I noticed about this man, that when I was handing the bread round at the communion service, all the deacons took their portion of bread. When he took his, he always muttered beneath his breath, "Thank you." And the same with the wine, "Thank you." And I had to point out to him that it was wrong to say thank you. If he was in my home as a guest and I handed him bread and butter, I'd expect him to say thank you. But not when he's taking a bit of bread at the communion service. You see, the whole thing is different. I'm not giving him the bread. I'm not giving him the wine. And he mustn't behave in this way. Politeness and the things that you do in society are even wrong here. The poor fellow had never realized what was taking place. No, no. What is needed is a sense of God, a sense of the Holy Spirit. Now, this does not mean that you put on a false dignity and become pompous. I'm talking about reverence and godly fear. Then let me hasten to say this. Don't put on a parsonic voice. What a terrible thing that is. Men do this. They get into a bad habit. They hear others and they do it. An affected, parsonic, unnatural voice. It offends people. Still worse is to put on a false appearance of piety. Sanctimoniousness. What a horrible thing it is. You remember how Spurgeon really used to ridicule this. He did it, whether he was right or wrong, in the case of people known as the Plymouth Brethren. And he put it like this on one occasion, adapting those words of Acts 1:11. "Ye men of Plymouth, why stand ye there looking up into the heavens?" You know, this people who sort of look up and a sanctimonious expression. What a terrible thing it is. And he also said another very wise thing, I think. He said, whenever you look at a man who has the reputation of looking very saintly, and who rather likes to think he does look saintly, you can be quite sure, said Spurgeon, that he's got a bad liver. I agree 100%. 100%. You see, the New Testament tells us if we are fasting to anoint the face with oil. And you do everything you can not to give the impression that you're fasting. You don't call attention to this. Then another thing, avoid chattiness and the so-called easy style. How horrible all this is in connection with these things. Never be histrionic. Don't cultivate or practice gestures. Everything that is histrionic should be avoided. What's the rule then? Well, the rule is be natural. Forget yourself. Be so absorbed in what you're doing and in the realization of the presence of God and in the glory and the greatness of the truth that you're preaching and the occasion that brings you together, that you're so taken up by all this that you forget yourself completely. That's the right position. That's the only place of safety. That's the only way in which you can honor God. Self is the greatest enemy of the preacher, more than any other man in society. And the only way to deal with self is to be so taken up and enraptured by the glory of what you're doing that you actually forget yourself altogether.
We do hope that you've been helped by the preaching of Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. All of the sermons contained within the MLJ Trust audio library are now available for free download. You may share the sermons or broadcast them. However, because of international copyright, please be advised that we are asking first that these sermons never be offered for sale by a third party, and second, that these sermons will not be edited in any way for length or to use as audio clips. You can find our contact information on our website at mljtrust.org. That's mljtrust.org.